We help you outsource easier with virtual paralegal and legal secretary services to help you get the work-life balance that you deserve. Today, I'm joined by the wonderful Molly McGrath from Hiring and Empowering Solutions. Molly, can you tell us a little bit about Hiring and Empowering Solutions and your role in the company?
Absolutely. Thank you for doing this, Stacey, for the legal community. So needed. And thank you for having me as your guest today. So I have been serving in the legal space for 26 years now. I have built four different companies for legal organizations in regards to coaching and consulting. My business that I fully focus on now is Hiring and Empowering Solutions, started back in 2008. Written two Amazon bestseller books. Also have been podcasting. I haven't missed one single week every Tuesday since for the past 2.5 years now. And I've been blogging every Thursday since 2008. The premise of my business, two sides of it, is legal staffing and hiring that also has a coaching and consulting and an onboarding side of it. And then I also serve as a fractional CEO and CMO for law firms across the country. I've coached and consulted in staff for over 4,000 law firms since 2008.
Fantastic. Well, today, Molly is going to provide us some wonderful and insightful information about why the employee review must die, including how to let go of old school employee evaluation mindset. And I will tell you, we talked about this before, and it's so interesting. I think it's so needed. And she's going to discuss to learn a new way of communicating with and empowering your employees and to learn how to create leaders leading leaders. So we ask that you please enter any questions you may have during this presentation in the chat, and Molly will go over them at the end of the webinar. So with all that said, Molly, let's jump in and get started.
Yes, excellent. I am so excited about this conversation, and I've been talking about employee reviews and how to really transform them for many, many years. And it's drastically changed even since the pandemic and people working in a virtual and a remote perspective and environment. So my goal today is for you all to walk away with some concrete ideas, tips, techniques, tools, and strategies that you can implement the moment you leave this lunch and learn today. And again, if you have any questions or you want additional resources, by all means, email us at info@hiringandempowering.com. We're going to be including the PowerPoint, a tool that I'd like to give as a giveaway, the Employee Growth Plan. We were going to put in the chat, but I understand we're going to be emailing you at the end. And also, you can by all means go to our website and opt in so you can get our value loaded podcasts that drop every Tuesday, and every Thursday we drop a blog that supports you with concrete strategies that are tested, proven within law firms across the country. So again, I shared a little bit about who I am. For almost 26 years now, I've coached and consulted and directed presidents and founders and built national legal organizations for over 4,000 law firms. And I'm very, very, very passionate with my second book that I wrote was called Entrepreneurs in an Entrepreneur's World, How to Get Your Employees to Step Up and Lead. And it's going to tie in really nicely with today's presentation in regards to how to get your employees to shift into becoming what I like to call an entrepreneur, where they have blood, sweat, tears, and they're very much see your clients as our clients. They don't have the employee mentality. They have completely eradicated coming into work, keeping your mouth shut, putting your head down, collecting your paycheck and going home and leaving it at the door. In fact, they come to you with proposed problem or proposed solutions versus constant problems. So this training is for you today. If you're done feeling exhausted, frustrated, and alone, and have no idea how to really conduct that stop restart with your team. So often when I get phone calls over the past 25 plus years, I'll hear from attorneys, they'll call me and say, oh, business would be great, but for the employees. And the employees will call and say, business would be great, but for the clients, they keep interrupting at me and I can't get my work done. So I really like to get everybody on the same playing field and get you back in alignment in regards to what it means for your employees to really put what I like to say, protect your back and really protect your calendar and instill confidence that you can finally let go while also really understanding that the clients are not an interruption or distraction to the work, but for the clients, you would not have a paycheck and or a job. So really want to help you with cracking what I like to call that employee code and feel like you have a place to turn, that you feel like people are no longer delegating back up to, and that you really have a process that works for employee reviews is a street term that people really anchor to, but really in shifting it into employee growth plans. So we all know what the greatest struggle for any business owner, especially as a small business owner, especially as an attorney, you know, it really is the team, the money and time are the number one frustration in most law firms because we don't necessarily have an ongoing continuous process that is ever present unless you as an entrepreneur are, as this visual is showing you, pushing it uphill. And that's how it feels day in and day out, especially if you have a revolving door. So often people will say to me, yeah, I've hired before. That didn't really work out. So I'm never going to do that again. Or I'm sick of telling people what to do, how to do it, only for them to come back with the same question over and over again. So might as well just do it all myself. How many times have you caught yourself or found yourself saying that day in and day out when it comes, whether it's a virtual employee and you're outsourcing or you're having a traditional employee that's in-house and or working in a remote environment. So the goal is really for your team to understand what you're up against as a business owner, as an entrepreneur, as on the, you know, client facing as an attorney and what they can do to support you along the way so we can get out of this vicious cycle and feeling like this, because this is not why you hung your own shingle. This isn't why you are running your own business. And so often, you know, I hire every day. And even yesterday, I probably talked to three different solo practitioners that were like, you know what? I hung my shingle. I did the solo practitioner thing. And I realized I just want a job. I don't want to deal with employees. I don't want to deal with payroll. I don't want to deal with all the headaches and the heartaches, having to constantly owe the file, et cetera. Do you have any law firm that's looking for an associate attorney? Because they get to this point and it doesn't have to be that way. It's just how do we kind of get out of this vicious cycle? And so if you are exhausted and feeling like the only person in the firm that is worried about revenue, working many hours, but then you're still paying people and you're the last person to get paid within the building. And that's the commitment that I have for law firms and have for over 25 years is to really break that cycle and start getting your employees to step up and lead. But there, it's a fine dance because you also need to have you as an entrepreneur to be able to let go. That's what I'll hear. The employee, the attorney will call me and say, you know, nobody will step up and lead. I keep getting things delegated back to me. And on the flip side of that, the employees will call me and say, you know, I'm being micromanaged. They won't let go. They won't let me take responsibility. I have all the responsibility, but I have absolutely no permission or authority to really take this and lead. And I know I can help them out. So this is the premise of really getting off of that roller coaster and getting off of weeks where you just don't know who's doing what to reach goal. And that is the premise of really killing the employee review mindset and moving into an employee growth plan. So you don't feel like you're constantly backed against the wall when it comes time for annual reviews and bonuses. How often do we feel you know, backed against the wall, or we have to give these discretionary bonuses because at the end of the year, you know, we feel like we should. Everyone's staring at us as a business owner looking for that Christmas bonus, that year-end bonus, whatever it means. We don't have any true measuring stick. So it no longer becomes a business decision. It becomes an emotional decision that's either out of guilt or shame or whatever it might be. And the vice versa, as the employee, when it comes time, you know, they feel bad. They know we're not reaching goal. This has been a tough year, what have you. And then I don't want to ask for my bonus or my raise. Now, I'm not really sure. It was a conversation that was sort of talked about when I was hired, but then nothing was ever said about it again. And it just becomes this emotional iceberg that is unnecessary before, besides setting up the standards front and center. And making certain that there's something that is living and breathing and everybody has the exact same expectations around it. Because there is so much emotional charge around, I mean, just the terminology, a review. You know, right there, it communicates and it feels for the employee like it's do or die. Your head, it's a performance. Your head's on the chopping block. It's a pass or fail. And then for the entrepreneur, they play these mind games with themselves a little bit. Like, and it's interesting because I hear this from attorneys all the time. A lot of times attorneys are misclassified as being, you know, hard and unapologetic and things of that nature. That's not my experience. When I talk to attorneys, they're like, well, you know, I don't want to be the bad guy. They're really, you know, leaning more so on the emotionality side of things. So it becomes really, really icky and convoluted, and it doesn't have to be that way. And the goal is for you to get freedom, financial freedom, emotional freedom, and energetic freedom. That is the one area that a lot of people do not measure, the energy. I always say you're responsible for the energy you leave in the room. As the employee, as an entrepreneur, as a client, as a referral source, whatever it might be. And so often we walk around with this frustration backpack on, and that's the one resource that we don't measure. But when you have an employee that just, you know, let a client cancel an appointment that could have had an average case value of $10,000 or $25,000 attached to it because they weren't properly trained as a client service coordinator and they're responsible for the calendar, or you have an employee that calls in sick or they messed up files or they messed up documents that you're about to walk in a signing meeting for and names are misspelled and things of that nature, you're bringing that energy into the room. Or you have a big, massive blow up within the office between two employees, and now you have to walk into that conference room or that Zoom room and land that next sale. And you're bringing that energy into the room. And that's a resource that so often we forget to measure as entrepreneurs and as, you know, because at the end of the day, that we always measure the human doing side of things, but we forget that we're hiring human beings, and that's the human stuff that typically gets us in a place of either somebody quitting or having to fire them. So the goal is with an employee growth plan is for you to have somebody that understand what it means for you to get your time back. So you're focusing on your top three revenue producing activities that only you as the attorney or you as an entrepreneur, or honestly, if we have any team members that are listening, you as a marketing coordinator, the client service coordinator, or the paralegal with the billable hour, whatever it might be, get your promises delivered onto clients, referral sources, team members, and to the attorneys, and then getting people followed up that will absolutely inherently increase your hire rate, which increases your cash flow, which increases your profitability. They all go hand in hand. So if none of these things are really, really the true problem in my experience when I go into law firms, it's really the problem is consistent team empowerment with enrollment and ownership. And I put the word consistent there because so often people will say, I had a firm that told me this yesterday too. They're like explaining to me about this, their client service coordinator, like she's not doing this, she's not doing that. We don't know if we should fire her, if she's the right person, what have you. And then I'm like asking them questions about what structures that they have in place to measure, to coach her up, to provide her the leadership and things of that nature, get her, make certain she's enrolled. Does she understand what it means to take ownership? And they say, yeah, we have this conversation and then it goes great for a little while. It's like this Oprah moment where the motivation works and she's, you know, lit up and she's engaged, empowered, enrolled, taking ownership and all that. But after a while, it just fades. So that's why I put the word consistent, because with standards and with consistency, that really, really is the key. And it doesn't have to be that simple. I know attorneys tell me every single day, I don't have time. Even when they call me and they want to hire someone, they're like, I don't have time to train people. I don't have time to babysit people. I don't have time to meet with employees. It's taking away from the billable hour, from doing the work. And I'm like, well, that's why you have this revolving door. This is why you consistently have these problems. So it's not about you're spending just as much time in communication ping pong with emails. You are spending probably four times the amount of time if you had a structure. And that's what we're going to really talk about today. So you can trust and let go of the day-to-day with confidence. That is a true thing. You need to have confidence, because it's one thing for me to sit here and tell you to trust and let go and to give it up to your team. But if you don't have the confidence to, it's never going to give you that freedom for entrepreneurial actions that actually scale and grow. So the goal is that you adopt and deploy and implement right away a quarterly employee growth plan that allow you to stop waking up at 2 a.m. in a panic because of money or missed promises to clients or missed deadlines or not even knowing where we are at with certain matters. For you to be able to generate a reliable and consistent stream of new clients every single solitary week. Guaranteed. And finally, let go of the control of the never-ending to-do list that continually grows and is dictated by others' emergencies. And you'll have a process to get back to consistent weekly time, not nights and weekends, to work on your creative business stuff every single week without fail, because that's what attorneys tell me all the time. I feel like I own a job. I don't feel like I own a business. I am craving, I am dying to get to those entrepreneurial actions, those top revenue producing activities, which you're in the personal services and professional services, which it's basically you're not selling a widget first and foremost, you are selling the relationship. The widget or the divorce documents or family law documents or estate planning documents, whatever you are delivering is not what creates your business. It's the relationships when you're front and center first and foremost. And you can't get to that if you don't have an empowered team that is on a consistent quarterly employee growth plan. So just changing the language of that. Just changing the language from a review to a growth plan, immediately the 2-millimeter shift and the subconscious shift that happens in your employee's mind, they will get excited about that. They will step up for that. You will not have any resentment about that because it's clear, concise, well communicated, and it's consistent. So that is the main thing that has to occur. So let me just talk to you a little bit about that. So number one is with the employee growth plan. If you have no employees right now, maybe you're considering hiring, and this goes for virtual employees. This goes for outsourced and contracted employees just as much. So when you hire them, day one that you start to, this is what you want to instill in them and empower them when you, okay, great. One of the things that distinguishes us in our marketplace, because I don't know if any of you have hired recently, the unemployment rate in the legal space is under 1% right now. It is unbelievable. It is a shark-infested waters with recruiters. Recruiters are vicious, searching for paralegals, searching for associate attorneys, searching for anybody that is worth their weight in gold, and they are efficient and effective, and they're out there. Then they're going to get hired and snatched up. And I'm going to be completely honest, they're going to get poached from your firm. And one way for you to be able to really keep, because this is a retention tool as well. When I do recruiting for law firms, I will say, you know, one of the reasons why you should consider working for my law firm here is because they have quarterly employee growth plans. They're like, whoa, what is that? I'm like, okay, let me tell you about that. Each quarter, you sit down with your attorney, and they're like, I've been with my firm for 5 years. I've never had anything. I do an annual review where maybe, you know, I get told all the things that I'm doing wrong, that I did wrong in January, that I'm just finding out about it 10, 12 months later, that I could have course corrected. The attorney's always so busy. I don't get these. So this is a selling point for you to, number one, get people to take your job, number one, when the market is so very tight, but number two, it's a retention tool for your employees. I cannot tell you how many times I have worked with law firms and I enrolled them into deploying this in their law firm. And I've had employees that have called me and said, I was 1 minute away from leaving the firm. That meeting, getting on an employee growth plan, completely transformed everything. I now have a North Star. I now have a vision. I understand the law firm's vision. I understand my role. I have a path of growth, and it's something that's broken into quarterly pieces that are very, very clear. So you're able to make consistent weekly cash flow that is not very complicated. When you have an empowered team that you know have your back and they have their eyes on the KPIs, the key performance indicators, and the ROIs, the return on investments. Now, listen, I know attorneys are probably freaking out. I'm not suggesting you open up your QuickBooks and you start showing P&Ls to your employees at all. There are ways to every single person in your law firm, especially the person who answers your phone, i.e., your sales force, i.e., your director of first impressions, i.e., your client service coordinator, they very, very much. I always tell people their return on investment. You can pinpoint, you should be getting a $225,000 annual return on that position. So it's not something you want to interact with as just a receptionist. Because if they don't do a good job of converting clients, then your job as the attorney is irrelevant because you won't have anyone to meet with because they didn't fill your calendar. Or they didn't fill your calendar with qualified people that actually want to engage you and retain you. So with the quarterly employee growth plan, there is standardization, there is predictability, there is consistency, and eliminates all the frustration and exhaustion and really allows for you to plan for your future self and live a practice. Every person on every in every role in every seat on the bus that has a vision for their future self. It's the most amazing retention tool ever. So number one, what stops the growth of a law firm, whether you're attracting employees or you're retaining your existing employees, whether they're independent contractors or W-2 employees that are on your payroll, is a lack of transparency. So often I will hear from attorneys, they'll say in regards to, they'll share these fluffy, what I'd like to call TJ Maxx signs that they find in the home goods area of quotes of, you know, about their mission, vision, values, things of that nature, but not really sharing what's stopping that growth. You know, meaning that, you know, I'm constantly in every client meeting. Things are getting delegated back up to me. Here's where I'm the bottleneck on things. Here's where I need help. When I have attorneys that start with transparency, you know, I would highly recommend anyone who's not familiar with Brené Brown and the work that she has done on vulnerability in organizations. and how people will absolutely take a bullet for you and will never, ever leave you when that is at the forefront of a law firm. It is just absolutely amazing. And it's scary because so often attorneys will say, well, I don't want to share all of it with my employees because I don't want to freak them out and be like, all right, I'm a little worried about the calendar. It's light. We don't have enough initial contact appointments right now. We don't have enough paying clients. We're not doing any follow-up, things of that nature. That's when people will lock arms with you and rally. So when there's a lack of transparency that's in the law firm, you know, from there, they're not really sure of what they can do to help you, but they hear all the time, I wish people would just step up and lead. And they don't know what that means. So when they know what that means, you know, and you're, if you aren't growing and you're stagnant, people will begin to focus on drama. It'll become inefficient and good people will actually want to be. So often when people come to me and I'm like, my number one question is, why are you looking for a new job? Why are you looking to leave your existing law firm? This is why. This is why they want to leave, because they're not connected to the heartbeat of the firm. And I get why attorneys so often don't want to share it, because they don't want to freak their employees out, or they believe, well, it's not their job. It's my job to fix money problems, calendar problems, what have you. And that's not, employees want to belong. If COVID has not taught us anything, people want to be part of a tribe. They want to belong to an organization, a law firm, that they are connected to the values, the core values, but also they are connected to the why. And Simon Sinek talks a lot about the why. And, you know, many of you probably read it within business books. If not, go YouTube, Google search it, what have you. It'll give you a crash course on how to get really clear on that and how to share that with your employees. And the other reason is that the lack of hiring process. This is so often why we have to get to that really kind of yucky place where we have to have those crucial conversations or brutal conversations or sit down, come to Jesus conversations with people. And we have to fire them or put them on performance plans or performance reviews. I've had firms that have come to me and they've sent to me when they're like, all right, well, so-and-so just quit. I'm like, all right, I want to really get into the mindset around this. Talk to me about why they quit. And so often they will say that they were constantly showing up late, or they were making mistakes, or they were violating process or what have you. So they write, the attorney writes up a formal letter, or their HR company does, and they slap them with this, you know, kind of like final notice or first notice. And people will leave. They don't have to tolerate that anymore because it doesn't feel like power and partnership. It doesn't feel like collaboration. So when you have a lack of hiring process where you're hiring, and again, I'd be happy to share my process with all of our attendees today, where you're sharing, you are interviewing from a place of mindset, emotional intelligence. Are they invested in being in a growth plan? Do they believe, are they coachable? Those are, again, I'll say it over and over again, it's the human being stuff that gets them in trouble versus the human doing stuff. So if you are lacking in your hiring process, that's something that you really want to start there before you dive into the employee review process. For your existing employees that you have right now, and for those that are rock stars, those that are maybe fence sitters, you're not sure, it's a 50-50 if they're gonna make it or not, or if you have employees that you're just not sure because you haven't given them their time and attention. It's a very, very quick way for you to figure out what's working and not working within your hiring process. And in fact, I'll give you a real quick drive-by coaching tip for you to do in your next team meeting or your next quarterly strategic planning meeting. Hopefully you have both those in place. If not, I'm gonna talk here in a few minutes about how to get those into place. Ask your team, Talk to them. Maybe send out a survey, depending on where you are with your transparency and vulnerability for with them and how safe, you know, you've made it in your organization and what your culture has for people to really speak their truth and give you their honest, well, respectful feedback. So check in on that. And this will tell you that, because when you ask the question and you get fine, which we all know, it's great, nothing wrong with it, what have you, when you get one word answer, so you don't get, you know, a tremendous amount of insight and feedback, that's an indicator that you're lacking that transparency. It's an indicator that you are lacking really, truly an organization where people's minds, thoughts, opinions, and insight are not only accepted, but really there's something you fully, wholly depend on, that they know it's safe to share. So really take a look at that. And again, it's about the employee mindset versus an empowering team. You'll know this within your hiring process. My very first book that I wrote was called Don't Be a Yes Chick. And so often, and the reason we came up with that fun title was because so often attorneys would hand their employees all these business books and they landed like, I want to fix you. So they go to these legal conferences or attend with their different coaches or what have you, get these really great books, Good to Great, you know, Think and Grow Rich, whatever they might be, the E-Myth. There, we all have just shelves and shelves of all these amazing, amazing books that just light us up as entrepreneurs. But when you have a culture that is built on based on your hiring process, based on hiring employees, and they should be lucky just to have a job, and then they're handed a book out of nowhere, but it's not a culture of coaching and empowerment and growth, it lands like, this is to fix you. And so that's when you know, versus having an empowering team where you have a culture of collaboration, you have a culture of coaching in there. So it will be very telling. You know, you have an employee mindset where they're clock watchers, or where they very much are just show up, put their head down, do their work, and then leave at the end of the day. They're not voicing opinions. And I'm going to talk to you about how to discern if you do have employee mindset and how to shift it into an empowering team here next. So to get you off of the, what they, you know, say all the time, the struggle bus, to keep team. This tool alone, the employee growth plan, is the greatest retention tool that you can get for underperforming employees or rockstar employees who maybe are not connected to a plan of growth and they're on the verge of leaving because they're bored, they're uninspired, they don't see you all growing as a firm. It's not a culture of coachability. It's not a culture of collaboration. And so this tool alone can really save someone. My favorite email when I'm inboxing people to recruit, to hire, like I said, the legal space is so tight. And quite often, many people are working at outsourcing for paralegal roles and things of that nature, what I am a very big fan of right now, because they do have that entrepreneur mindset and they do operate from a place of protecting your time and calendar and coming to you with proposed solutions versus constant problems. But my favorite email is when I'll inbox people, my subject line will just be, are you happy at your current job? And my greatest win for the day is when I get a response from people on LinkedIn or any other platforms that I use. And they say, yes, I'm very happy at the firm I work for. And I'm not even interested in talking to you. That makes me so happy. I'll actually go search the firm that they work for and send that. If I can find an email for the hiring manager or for the entrepreneur or attorney, I will take the time to send them an email and say, you know, keep up the great work. Whatever you are doing, your employees won't even talk to recruiters because they are very happy. And quite often, most of the time, it's nothing to do with the salary you're paying them. Yes, people need to put food on their table and gas in their tanks. But by and large, when people, I have many people who have taken massive pay cuts, to be part of a culture and a law firm that has a plan of growth. And they have a law firm of approachability, coachability, and vulnerability. So here's how we're going to get started. How to get a weekly empowering employee growth plan. And you can do this all really, truly, as Stacey said at the beginning, my favorite, you know, my mantra is creating leaders, leading leaders. And we all do, we're sick of babysitting employees, and employees are sick of babysitting their boss. So this is what I'd like to call an adult conversation and building a culture of adults. So number one is really creating a team leader that is not you as an entrepreneur. Even if you just have one employee, even if you just have a virtual paralegal or what have you, really having a crucial conversation with them, a courageous conversation, an open conversation of saying, you know, I really want to start adopting that we meet and have a weekly stakeholders meeting. And I use that term purposely. Every person in your business is a stakeholder. They have heart and soul and compassion for what you do, for your clients, for you, for the product that goes out the door. They are a stakeholder in their mind, and they embody in blood, sweat, and tears. They use terminology like our clients. They use terminology like we. So you have a weekly stakeholders meeting because everybody has stake in the game from the seat that they sit in with a firm, whether paralegal, associate, client service coordinator, marketing coordinator, what have you. Same place, same time every week. Here's the deal where attorneys screw up. They start to ditch these meetings, and they typically ditch the meetings because there is not an agenda, or people are looking to them to lead and to direct this meeting. And then it becomes like a coffee clutch, or it feels like a big administrative assistant meeting where we're not pointing towards true north. So you want to designate somebody on your team to be the team leader, not the attorney. You want to have a weekly stakeholders meeting that is led with an agenda. Again, happy to give you all the agendas that I use to lead over 4,000 law firms. That does work. It absolutely does work when it's facilitated. 1 hour meeting once a week, same place, same time. Ideally, Monday mornings, treat it as your locker room huddle before you go on your Super Bowl playing field. And it's facilitated. It's one thing to have an agenda. It's another thing to have an agenda that goes wild and it's not facilitated by someone. So now it's just this big coffee clutch with an agenda that we're all staring at that we don't follow, which just leverages the frustration. And then people will eventually, after 3 weeks, stop showing up. We're creating a culture of proposed solutions versus problem mindset. And we have weekly key performance indicators that are profit focused versus emotional focused employees. People are really, really clear. And when I use the terminology profit, you as entrepreneur know the profit center there. You know the profitability in there, but the employees' actions that they do, if they're managing the calendar, the life cycle of the file, what have you, their activities are leading towards that profit. Again, I'm not a proponent of opening up your QuickBooks and looking at your P&L and your profitability in these meetings. It's that their activities and actions are profit centered. And then you have employee growth plans quarterly with incentive-based structure. And I'm going to give you the tool. We don't have time today to walk through the entire tool. It is all laid out for you in that presentation, employee growth plan. You have them pre-scheduled throughout the year. They're on the employee's calendar. They're on your calendar. Everybody's very clear on them. The employee does a self-evaluation, and then you do an evaluation of them, and then you come together and have a coaching and a leadership conversation. This is about for you where the other person leaves motivated to own it. It is not, you know, may not be clear on what it is, but they're never afraid to clarify and verify and ask for clarity because they have it in their bones. They own their job. It's an empowering conversation that only has to happen once. And nobody is afraid or resenting this meeting at all. So even when there's crucial parts of it, and you'll see in the tool where we say what's working, what's not working, areas of improvement, you're not holding back as the entrepreneur, because 9 out of 10 times when the employee does a self-evaluation, when you have an empowered employee, they are harder on themselves than you are on them. Because their standards and their bar for excellence for themselves, for the expectation for the firm that they belong to, is so high. So often when I facilitate these employee growth plans, the employee will do a self-evaluation from their perspective of themselves, number one, of the firm, and they also have an opportunity to give ideas and areas for improvement. And there's many questions in there that are from a coaching perspective, from a growth perspective, from an adult conversation perspective. And you'll know very quickly two things. One, if you have an empowered employee based on the depth of their questions. When they are writing, you know, a mini dissertation in each session, that a lot of times you're like, wow. Like, I never thought that. I didn't see that. I would love for you to start taking that over. But when you see it, people that have just one answer, nothing, fine, you know, maybe one or two things. Oh, I wish that, you know, I had a newer computer, or they have these very surfacey things that they see for areas of improvement. You know that maybe, and this is a gut check that you have to ask yourself as a leader and entrepreneur. Do I really have a culture of empowerment? You know, are our core values, where people are allowed to speak the truth in an honest, well, respectful manner, that their opinion matters, that their insight matters? And if you can honestly, honestly say a resounding, absolutely yes to that, then you know it might be a hiring problem. It might be that the person is not the right person. They do not believe in growth plans. Again, depending on what your hiring process was for them to come in. But it's a great way for you to really do quality control analysis in every department, from your hiring process to your leadership process to your structures for your weekly team meetings, to make sure you're pointing everyone towards true north. Everybody knows what their key performance indicators are for every role that they sit in within the organization, and that there's accountability, tracking, measurement, and consequences attached to that. Then this meeting, this employee quarterly employee growth plan, nobody resents it. They actually look forward to it. You do as an entrepreneur, and they do as the employee. And by and large, the employee is facilitating and leading this meeting. When you look at what they do for their part of the self-evaluation, first and foremost, they have so many things that you're both just so on the same page of it. It's almost treated like a think tank and a brainstorming session versus a thing that has a tremendous amount of dread attached to it. So, the goal is that you never have to worry about money, follow-up, delivering on your promises ever again. Your clients, your referral sources, and how would you feel? How would it affect your energy? How would it affect your life? How would it impact your home life? That's another measuring stick of when we come back into, you know, where the saying of wherever you go, there you are. So the question for you, where are you right now? Do you have to have a crucial conversation with a certain team member, or maybe multiple team members? Do you find yourself using defensive language? Whether you're the employee, the team leader, or the entrepreneur, managing attorney, whatever role you are in, does your team use defensive language, which causes you to shut down and give them important feedback, consistent feedback? So then that gets us in the vicious cycle of, I'll just do it myself, or I'll take it back, or I'll give it to someone else. And then you have people on your payroll that you're paying that you're not getting a return on investment with. Or do you need to better understand the way your team is wired and how to communicate effectively with them? And really, again, asking yourself, do you have a firm culture of empowerment and growth? because it is the greatest retention tool. And we all know, we've seen the numbers and they consistently are climbing of what it costs to hire and onboard a new employee is north of $50,000 per employee per year. So get that return on investment up there. So today we've learned how to conduct empowering growth plans versus performance reviews. Again, the tool will be emailed to you afterward. How to create consistent cash flow, decrease your stress and your workload, and have amazing employees and get back to your sacred time to think and act and operate like a business owner that you signed up for when you hung your own shingle. And that is with the weekly stakeholders meeting. 1 hour a week. That is it. And how to have crucial conversations in a way that empowers versus deflates others for long-term action and accountability and retention as employees. So they are always leveling up and they're always growing up and become, I always say to employees, your job is to replace yourself. Your job, because you, that means that you are on a path of growth. You start out as a receptionist and you move into a legal assistant, then maybe paralegal, whatever your path and plan for growth is. And so when you have the employee growth plan in place quarterly, hardwired on everyone's calendars, expectations, everybody knows the pre-work that they need to do before, when you have to have those water cooler conversations, real time conversations for course correction and be able to give that critical coaching feedback or those crucial conversations, there's no anxiety around it. There's no emotionality around it. It's an adult conversation. And when you have it in real time and you're anchoring to their growth plan and their top activities, it just de-energizes all of it. It's a business conversation. And that's what I hear from attorneys and employees alike that they're craving and that they're desperate for. So thank you. I know we went over a lot today. We only have an hour. I've done all day workshops on this conversation, but really wanted to give you some hope, allow for you to finally have a path and plan to anchor to for keeping people connected to their quarterly goals every single week and being able to check in on them every week so you as the attorney can get that freedom that you wanted when you hung your own shingle.
Wow, Molly, that was so great. Let me just tell you, because we work with a lot of attorneys as well, and I can tell you that when they come to us for their virtual paralegal or legal secretary services, a lot of the times it's a solo or somebody who just hung their shingle out, and we're going to be their first experience with working with, you know, a team member. And a lot of times, you know, it's a really hard avenue for them to navigate because because there's so much that goes into working and communicating well. And so I know that everything you just said, like, can definitely apply to a lot of our clients and definitely would be a good education for them as well when they're deciding to work or hire a new team member. You know, one thing I did want to ask was when you were talking about those weekly, meetings together and you have the team leader that is not the attorney, are you looking into the KPIs that everybody's hitting at that time? Or are you looking at that at another time at like an independent meeting for each employee?
Oh, I love that question. That's fantastic. Yes, you are doing some what I call like to call self-management work beforehand. So when you're walking in, it's treated like a stand-up military meeting. So you're running the reporting and we can have a whole conversation on the five key focusers to run a law firm. But you are looking at it, which measures every role within the firm. And then you're coming to the meeting and you pretty much know the questions that you want to have from a clarification and verification. Again, coming with proposed solutions versus problems, because if you're not armed with the powerful questions that are very laser first and foremost, you're like, okay, I see a disconnect. You know, I see we got X amount of leads that came in, but 0% of them converted into initial consultation, client services, what's going on the phone. And I see this is where they all, you know, they might all come from a Facebook ad or what have you. And it's something that you just tried. So you're saying I assert it's because we just deployed this Facebook ads right now, the retail leads versus what have you. So you're coming with the coaching essence. You're coming with the proposed solution essence to it. So there's a part where you are anchoring to each employee's top three goals, because part of that stakeholders meeting agenda is for each person to give a very quick update on their top three. What are they? And they are alignment and attached to their growth plan. And of course, there's ancillary to-dos and tasks and emergencies that happen. But as long as those become an exception and not a norm, and if they become a norm, then it gives us the opportunity to really have a think tank and figuring out, okay, do we need to hire someone else? This is what tells you exactly and precisely where you need to hire, where we have a breakdown in process because people keep getting interrupted and things of that nature. It's such a beautiful, beautiful blueprint to really anchor to. It will show you the holes in your people, your process, your production, and your profitability.
Definitely. Well, and to expand on that a little bit, because I know that some people, you're talking about defensive language, and I know some people take questions the wrong way when they have to answer certain things. They might get a little bit defensive, or when you communicate things in a certain way, somebody might take it and it, you know, as off-putting. Is there a tool or anything you recommend to learn better communication to stay away from defensive language?
Yes. You know, for a real easy, one of the things I love to have firms do, easy way to get on this bus of having clear, concise communication, adult conversation, is pick a book. Best one that I've ever read was Crucial Conversations. And there's one that's Crucial Conversations in the Workplace. During your team meeting, you can have a 10-minute segment where we are going to read a chapter or two each week, and then we're going to just debrief. And what I love about that is it, you know, breaks down where we have lack of trust, or do we start with heart and things of that nature. But in the meantime, when you have a framework like that to anchor to get started, in there, you come up with your ground rules. And so when you give people that we are an organization of change, we have your core values. We are an organization where Good to Great by Jim Collins says the health of any organization is your ability to have the fist pounding conversations. So we are an organization where we have honest conversations. I don't like the word brutal honesty. I like courageous conversations better. So in real time, I'll give you an example real quick. Is even today, I facilitate a daily huddle with the team. So I'm their fractional CEO. Every morning, 6:30 in the morning, my time, I manage a firm, 8:30 Eastern time. It's 15 minutes. There are five people on there. There's the managing attorney, there's the paralegal, legal assistant, client service coordinator, and then their legal intern on there. So we're able to accomplish everything in 15 minutes. And in this call, the managing attorney, I love it because the paralegal goes, he was frustrated with her. She didn't get to her daily task for the day before, what I have you. And I love it because she stopped and we do it on Zoom and she's like, time out. You know, I hear your frustration and you're getting frustrated. It's making me defensive right now. I don't like that I have to defend my position. So I hear that you're frustrated. And it was about entering billable time every single week, every day, in which is a big problem in law firms. But she was behind on that. And she kept having reasons and excuses and what have you. And then when she finally said to him, what is the root of your frustration? He said it and she's like, I get it. That's valid. Okay. Now I understand. Okay, great. Problem went away immediately. So the ability to have the real time conversations, when you have defensive language, stop it immediately in real time. Be like, whoa, 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 time out. You just triggered me, or you just, you know, right now I'm feeling like I'm defensive, or your language is attacking right now. And neither one of us are going to produce any results out of this conversation. So what's at the root of this? Definitely. And just have it right there, because otherwise people shut down, watch your body language. They cross their arms. They start picking up their phone. Their head goes down. They disengage. And then they carry that throughout the entire day, sometimes weeks and sometimes a lifetime, until they finally quit or get fired.
That's a great example because, you know, it's actually, I think, perfect because it shows that two-way channel communication of the attorney being frustrated, the paralegal being like, hey, like I'm about to, you know, shut down, I'm getting defensive, and then working together to communicate and finding that solution without having it be this long-term issue together. And so one thing I want to show, if you're okay with it, Molly, if you have time, I would love to just briefly show the employee growth plan.
Yes.
Kind of just, you know, do a quick screen share of that so that, you know, I find it just so interesting. It's so in depth and just, you know.
Yes.
Here it is for everybody. Okay. So as you scroll down, you can see, you know, the different things in it in terms of, you know, the different things it asks, how it starts. And I really find that this is going to be, and again, for those who are watching this on replay, they can, you guys can get it from Molly's website at hiringandempowering.com. And so I just find this so amazing how in depth it is. And this allows your employee to actually fill it out. And this is kind of what you're talking about, having them, you know, evaluate themselves. And it gives things, attitude, how's your creativity, dependability. And I find this so great because, you know, they're not, there's these key concise questions of them to actually have to think about themselves and be honest, you know, and answer truthfully here. And this document is 10 pages long and it's so in depth and I find it just so fantastic. I want to, you know, use this even for my own team. And so it's just so great how impactful these questions can actually be for your team to really understand your employee, because there it's not just you telling them what they did wrong or what you want them to change. It's easy to think that you may know every single thing your employee is doing, but in reality, I always say I have maybe 10% knowledge of what it is my employees are actually doing, because they are the ones putting in the work day in and day out. And I look to them for their guidance with different things. And, you know, like you said, if they evaluate themselves with this document, I'm sure they're going to be harder on themselves than we are on them. Because I know for a fact, my amazing project manager, anytime she makes a mistake, even if it's so minuscule, I know she beats herself up about it. I'm like, stop, you're amazing. You know, mm-hmm. Like, you don't need to feel that way. Like, we all make mistakes. We're humans. If we didn't make mistakes, you know, we'd be robots. And so I find this just so amazing how in depth it is, just allowing the employee to fill this out and you actually really getting a sense of who they are, what they are doing, and how they feel about your business and what they can be doing better. And it's just, you know, I don't think that it would take, how long do you think that an employee would need to invest their time in filling this out?
An hour. So that's what I typically react. And that's why I give a sample on that to Stacy, is because mm-hmm. I want to give the employee some concrete examples of really deep dive into it and to communicate to them that your opinion matters and yeah. We want you to be truthful. So I recommend the employee spends an hour. So if the review is scheduled for next Monday, that they put in the calendar 2 weeks before, if not three, depending on the attorney's busy calendar, whoever's managing them, then they give it to the attorney. They're going to spend about an hour, whoever the supervisor, manager, what have you is in that, and they're going to have a time. So everybody shows up prepared with it. They get a copy of it, and then you show up, and it's each person has the opportunity to kind of highlight it and be like, you know, I want to talk about this because I rated myself here, or the attorney would say, you know, I want you to know the reason I rated you low on this, because at this point, you really should be here and you're not. And I'm rating you low here, but I want to figure out, is it that we didn't give you the resources? We didn't give you the training? We didn't. So it's a deeply curious conversation versus a blame game.
Absolutely. I just find it so amazing how in depth that is. And again, if you're watching this on replay, you can get on Molly's website at hiringempowering.com. And for everybody watching live or who registered for the webinar, we'll be emailing this document to them as well. And I really think that this is a great, not even just starting point, just a useful tool already. Of course, every business can build on it and find their own questions to add in, but it's just absolutely amazing. And so this is a tool that you generally give out to law firms to use with their staff. And so I'm sure you've seen great success with this because you use it. And so I just find it so amazing. It's definitely like worth money instead, you know, but it's a freebie. So I just wanted to show that to kind of show how in depth it is and that it isn't just, you know, quick, like check yes or no questions. It's really in depth to really learn about your employees and really get into that mindset that Molly was talking about. So everyone, that's everything we have today. Yeah. Again, everyone, thank you so much for your time and your energy and learning about how to create leaders leading leaders. I think that's an amazing phrase. I love that. Well, Molly, again, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you
so much. Thank you, everybody. Take care.
All right. Have a great day.